What's good, Wager World? It's your boy, Five Star in Vegas, broadcasting live as always from beautiful Summerlin, in Nevada, and here with my co-host, my guy, the only Sacramento Kings fan that I know. What's good, Spread Astaire? How are you today?
I'm great, man. I've gone over the lines this week. I ran my numbers, and a lot of my numbers came pretty close to the lines these books put up. So I can't wait to talk to you about some of these games because I think there's some great arguments on both sides of a lot of them. You've cracked the formula as of late. Been on a huge winning streak. Can't wait to keep riding that success.
NFL is starting, the mile is starting to really work. We've had some success, as we'll talk about a little bit later in past, present, and future. We'll talk about the game last night and the previous game. Just briefly, great time in Houston, as we talked about shortly yesterday. What a series by Yordan Alvarez. What a series by Jeremy Pena for the Houston Astros. They took the best shot that the Mariners had. Two games. You got Dusty Baker having to set the pitching perfectly because of the lackluster performance by Justin Verlander. Astros clawed back from a four-run deficit twice in that game and still win the game with Yordan Alvarez with the historic walk-off in the bottom of the ninth with two outs. And then he follows up in game two, and it's a completely different type of game. Seattle has his ace dealing, Luis Castillo. Valdez did not have his best stuff for the Astros. Still, Dusty Baker's able to navigate that. He uses the bullpen brilliantly. And once again, Carlos Pena sets the table by having a great at-bat in the two spot. Ends up getting on base again. This caused Yordan Alvarez a chance to take the lead. He does. He doesn't miss. He goes the other way. Hits a tailing fastball from Castillo that was breaking off the plate about 3 inches. Only a hit that Yordan Alvarez this time could make. He's literally turned right before eyes into the new Barry Bonds with his ability to not miss when the ball's in the strike zone. Left-handed, beautiful stroke. He ends up winning the game with that home run for the second straight time. And then the Astros tack on a run later. And we end up winning 4-2 in game two. Once again, Jeremy Pena sets the table. Another great at-bat this time. He gets a walk. And when he gets the walk, they end up walking Yordan Alvarez this time because they're afraid of him. And then Bregman comes up first pitch and goes the other way and gets the much-needed tack-on run for the ninth inning. And the Astros hold on and defeat Seattle. So we're pretty excited, the Houston fan base, about what's going on with the Astros. Also, you got this stuff going on with Deion Sanders and the SWAC. He's turned it to a rallying cry for him and his young boys over there at Jackson State. Coach Eddie Robson, crazy, he's named after, I guess, Coach Eddie Robson from Grambling State University, where he coaches at Alabama State, and he was upset with Deion. He said that Deion walked on his side of the field before pregame, didn't talk to him, and then afterwards tried to give him a shake and a pound, and Robson was beefing with Deion and said he wasn't SWAC because Deion went to FSU and then go to a SWAC school, which is such BS. Jackson State is getting a brand new stadium built right now that would have never got okay in other times past if it wasn't for Deion's influence. Deion is bringing all types of exposure to the SWAC. It's just a coach being jealous, man, and he doesn't want to give Prime his props, so he has to find something to pick at him with, and he's trying to say he's not SWAC. Well, Deion's turned that into an anthem with I Am SWAC, and he has his team pretty fired up about that. That's just some of the things that's going on in sports. It's so much. Let's get to the past. Talk a little bit about the last football games that have went on in the NFL.
And do we even want to talk about them? I'll be honest, on our other show, I just skipped. We didn't even recap the game last night. We literally did not recap the game. You know why I'm sick, though? I watched the whole game. And something that I noticed, and I saw you tweet about the same thing, and it kind of sucks because I've been like a Fields defender, but boy, he's taking a long time to get through his reads.
And yeah,
I'd like to blame the team for not putting people around him, but I just looked. He's averaging 3.6 seconds per release. Now, obviously, that does get moved up for mobile quarterbacks, but it's still 0.2 seconds higher than everyone else. And then the eye test kind of confirmed last night. It didn't seem like, oh, well, it's because he's scrambling so much. It really seemed like he was sitting in the pocket. It takes a while to get through his reads. I was really hoping Fields would be good. My buddy Tyler, you met Tyler. He's telling me no way. So far, it looks like Tyler's right. Give me your takeaway on Justin Fields and just that debacle in general.
I've never seen a quarterback regress so much from college to the pros. And that all has to do with coaching. He probably was getting better coaching from Ryan Day than he's getting from Matt Eberflus right now at the professional level. Matt Eberflus is a defensive-minded coach. Their GM did a horrible job. Everyone else is spending all this money. As you said, you saw Kyler Murray, they traded for Hopkins. You see Josh Allen, they're always drafting receivers, picking up free agents for him. When it got Diggs for him, and you saw the immediate jump in Josh Allen's career. A lot of people don't understand that that was simultaneous with him getting a big-time receiver over there, that everything changed for Josh Allen. Everyone acts like Josh Allen just out there doing it with no-name receivers. He has one of the top five receivers in the football right now. So that helped him a lot. All of these young quarterbacks get help, whether it's the offensive line, whether it's the weapons. All of them are getting help except for Justin Fields. Justin Fields can play. At this point, he's almost like David Carr was, where he's kind of just shell-shocked. He's so used to getting hit and getting hit hard from protection breaking down that now he's starting to see ghosts, you know. And I think he's going to be just fine, especially if he's blessed enough to get traded. I'd love for his camp to get him out of Chicago, and he has the right agent that he works with to get him out of camp. You know, he signed with the same agent as Deshaun Watson and Jalen Ramsey. That guy does not play games. Athletes first. If they see that their quarterbacks are in a bad situation or any of their players, they will raise hell, and they have the media contacts in order to get the type of messaging that they want out. So in the offseason, if this continues, I won't be surprised at all if we see Justin Fields get the hell up out of Chicago. And I bet you if he goes somewhere with a competent coach and a competent GM, competent organization, he'll be able to succeed. Even when the Bears were at their highest levels, they've never cared about the quarterback. They've never catered to a quarterback. When they were their best in 86, Jim McMahon, look at his numbers. They were horrible. He was just one of the guys. He wasn't a superstar. Some teams draft well at different positions historically for the organization. And the Bears historically draft the hell out of defense, middle linebackers are their stars. To this day, Roquan Smith is the best player on the team. He's the best draft they had in the last few years. They know how to draft linebackers. That's what they do. They do not know how to draft and develop quarterbacks. That's why the city of Chicago was really excited when they got Justin Fields, because everyone knows Justin Fields could play. The problem is now how are they going to develop him? He's pretty much been set up to fail by Ryan Pace and by Matt Eberflus. They should have gave coach that they had last year another year with him, and he might would have been able to develop the same things with him that his mentor was able to do with Mahomes and KC. So I just think that he needs an offensive coach, and he definitely needs a different organization unless the Bears are going to catch up to 2022, because at this time, they're still one of those organizations who simply don't know how to develop or draft quarterbacks.
Yeah, I was just worried that, boy, it might be tough for him to come back from this. The beneficiary of one of the worst roughing the passer calls ever, and we still couldn't get the win. Unbelievable.
Though. And they were also the victim of one of the worst defensive holding calls ever, which probably mattered just a little bit more at the end of the game, because the Chiefs missed the field goal and the Raiders would have had the ball with the lead with the fourth quarter waning, and they could have ran the clock out, because as you know, like I know, Josh Jacobs was not being stopped. He was getting 6-7 yards of run. So I think they kind of evened out on the bad calls with that, even though it was a horrible call against Chris Jones, against Derek Carr. I feel like it was even a worse call that affected the game with them, the guy missing the field goal, and then you call a defensive holding, and these guys are just tangled up fighting for position. Like, that was a horrible call, and I'm so sick of these referees just guessing as they go out here and not really – being held accountable for the decisions that they make that are affecting a lot of people's money out here. Getting back to that game, I was dead on with Alvin, the clients, and I've hit that one. We haven't lost an NFL game, I think 6 straight now. And I told you before that game, too, even though all the numbers didn't suggest it, take the Raiders. Josh McDaniels would have them ready to play. Devonta Adams with a big game. What do you think about this clown jumping in front of him as he's leaving the stadium all amped up, and just jumps out of nowhere in front of him, and then this turkey goes and files a police report, and then Kansas City should be ashamed in their district attorney department for even picking that case up. It's all about media. It's all about them trying to get a little exposure in that office, because it makes no sense to even have this man come into court for that. When someone walks in front of you and you just push him out the way, he's a professional football player, the highest played receiver in the game, walking off the field by himself with no security. Somebody just jumps in front of him. His first thoughts is, hey, get out of my way and let me get to my locker room. I'm on enemy territory. It's weird people in this world jumping on the field and running across all the time. It's weird people attacking people at all times. You just now, literally 24 hours after the guy stabbed those showgirls in Vegas, 24 hours before that, excuse me, my wife and my son and I were walking on that same bridge, going to lunch, you know, having a good day, taking a walk down the strip from Palazzo to the Fashion Show Mall. And in that same area the next day, a guy runs up on two showgirls who just had spoke to us the day before and stabs both of them. So we're in a crazy world, and a lot of people are not comfortable with people running all up on them. And this kid just runs out of nowhere with this big camera on him in front of him and surprises him. He does what I would have done too. He pushed him out his way and went on to the locker room, and now this guy trying to file a lawsuit. I'm so sick of these people.
I mean, I think you summed it up all right there. Not necessarily a surprise in the world we lived in, though, but I think you hit the nail on the head there.
All right, let's get to the present, man.
All right, the first game I wanted to talk about, Clemson heads down south to Florida State. How do you see that playing out there? It's a traditional ACC battle, right?
Tallahassee, they were clamoring about the Seminoles were back after they upset my LSU Tigers in New Orleans to start the season. But as we're learning, as the year progresses, it pains me to admit LSU just isn't that good, man, this year. That victory doesn't look nearly as impressive now. And since conference play has begun, the Seminoles have crashed back down to earth. They were rolled by Wake Forest 2 weeks ago. Last week, they blew a lead against NC State. I believe after 2 weeks of that physical play against two of the conference's best two teams, last thing FSU wanted to see pulling up to Doak Campbell was the ACC bully, Clemson. You know, they've dominated this conference for a decade now. Dabo has beaten the Seminoles six straight seasons, and he still remembers having to wrestle control of the ACC from Florida State, so he's never having a hard time to get him or his team up for that game. When they see that garnet jersey and those gold helmets, they're usually knowing that it's going to be a big-time game. And as great as Clemson has been over the past decade, they're probably the most underrated team in America this year because, surprisingly, man, DJ Uiagalelei has really played well. I was really down on him, but it's very refreshing to see the type of leadership he's displayed this year and also the talent that's starting to appear again that made him a top recruit when he was coming out of St. John Bosco. The Tigers seem to be coming together at exactly the right time. Dabo Swinney has already established himself as one of the best coaches and program builders. He just doesn't lose these type of conference games. It'll be a night with the whole nation watching because it's a night game from Doak Campbell and Tallahassee. So I expect we see the best out of Clemson. Their defense is going to continue its dominance over Florida State. Clemson only allows 18 points per game, and they're second in the nation against the run, only allowing 62 yards per contest. That's pretty good. That means the game's going to have to come into the hands of Jordan Travis, the quarterback for Florida State. And he's been having some difficulty protecting the ball and also being a pass first team. He's really a quarterback that's better athletically than he is at sitting in the pocket. FSU is 1-9 in their last 10 games after allowing less than 20 points in their previous game. So when they struggle on offense, they struggle. Clemson is 6-1 against the spread in their last seven conference games. And also the Tigers are 4-0 against the spread in the last four meetings with Florida State. I got to go with the class of the ACC here, man. I think this is a bad number because what the books are saying right here is if they want a neutral field, that it'll be about 6 points. And I think that the Tigers will beat Florida State by much more than 6.5 points on a neutral field. So even though the Florida State's at home, I like where Clemson's going. I like their dominance. And I think they're trying to really prove something this year. So let's go with Clemson with the short number, the -3.5. I'll be playing that one.
All right, five-star likes Clemson. Let's talk about Alabama heading to Knoxville, Tennessee. Tennessee, I didn't expect them to be ranked number 6 at this point in the year, but here we are. Alabama 6-0, Tennessee 5-0. Tennessee catching 7 at home. What do you think?
Tough game right here, man. A lot of people on Tennessee. So many so that now it's making me a little uncomfortable. At first, I was drinking the orange Kool-Aid myself, too. Looks like Bryce Young will be back for this game to play, so that's huge for Alabama. only thing that can stop Bryce Young is Bill O'Brien. And that's what I worry about when you're dealing with Bill O'Brien having to face this Tennessee team that we know are going to put up points. So it's going to come down to Bama being able to answer the bell toe-to-toe with them, because I don't see Alabama's defense being able to totally shut down Tennessee. Tennessee has a great quarterback at Hurton Hooker, who's really coming into himself now. He's a grown man. He's 25 years old. Like, you know, with this COVID stuff, these guys out here now, older than us, playing quarterback and having, you know, so many snaps now.
And with NIL, I think that's going to continue.
Yeah, man. So he's like, right? He has so much experience. It's ridiculous, man. But the line has climbed up to 8.5 since the return of Bryce Young has been announced. Now, I like that 8.5 a lot better than that 7. That's the latest line. It's up to 8.5. Anytime you got an offense that plays the way Josh Heupel team play with so much speed, so many big plays, you have to take that many points. You know, anything less than a touchdown. I even think you get the back door when, you know, Alabama starts going a little prevent at the end of the game if they're able to get up. But at 8.5, the line just changed. But after the announcement of Young coming back, I got to like Tennessee with those 8.5, man. I know, like you said, I said never bet against Brady and bet against Saban, but things change and things evolve. And Alabama hasn't looked as dominant this year as they have in the past. Talent differential between Alabama and the country is really narrowing now. So they're not this big beast like they were before, where they come in and just physically dominate you. I think Tennessee can hang with them in the trenches, and I know that they can hang with them athletically. So now it comes down to quarterback play. Can Hurton Hooker match Bryce Young play for play? We know Bryce Young is a magician. He's a winner. The thing about him, he might have a little rust. He hasn't played in 2 weeks. So I'll be on Tennessee if I have to play a side. I probably tease it up, though, to 15.5 with the over. Right. Yeah.
Let's talk about two more undefeated teams this time in the Big Ten. Penn State, ranked number 10, 5-0. Number 5, Michigan, is 6-0. They meet in Ann Arbor. Always a great rivalry. How do we approach this one? Because this one's going to be fun. For us, it's 9 a.m. I mean, it's great.
Yeah. Perfect way to start the morning, right?
I know. I love it. It's like right when I'm ready to sit down and start watching.
And we're sitting in all this sun, and it's getting crisp where they're at. So we enjoy being here, because we get like 8 months in California and Southern Nevada are like the same weather. You know, it's sunny and 70 to 90 to 100 degrees up in there somewhere, you know, year round. We rarely get cold weather. So it's, you know, it's always interesting early in the morning getting up, seeing those East teams play. And I expect a really exciting game between these two teams. They always play games against each other. You're dealing with two of the best coaches in the Big Ten, Jim Harbaugh. Of course, Penn State's coach. He's always been an unbelievable coach, man. One of the more underrated coaches, actually, in my opinion. He doesn't get enough props for the jobs he's done at Happy Valley. I know they haven't won a championship or anything, but still, Coach Franklin always has a formidable team, man. And they always give Michigan all that they want. Actually, they've beaten them two of the last three occasions. I actually like the 7 points. The reason I like it is because, okay, Michigan is a dominant team. Penn State did not look good last week, barely squeaking by Northwestern at home. But I think that the reason why they looked that way is because Franklin was playing a little tuck. I don't think he was showing a lot of the stuff that they're going to run against Michigan. So, you know, James Franklin's a sharp guy. He'll have those guys ready to keep that game within 7 points, because Penn State always brings deep. Penn State has a quarterback, another one who's been there forever, in Clifford. He's had a lot of experience in the Big Ten. Another one who's had so many starts. He's been starting off and on since a freshman. It's been about 5 years. And I just, with those type of points and with the way that Michigan, their offense is up and down. Sometimes they can put up points against lesser competition, but in other times, you know, they struggle to move the ball. I don't think Penn State's just going to roll over like that against them. 7 points is just, you know, that's a little bit over a touchdown. It's a little bit too much to give up in a game between two sharp coaches, two veteran teams. And the advantage that Penn State is going to have, a quarterback, having a much more seasoned quarterback than Michigan's starting quarterback. So if anything, I'm going with Penn State, but most likely I'll just watch this game.
All right. Can't wait to watch that one kick off. Of course, bright and early, 12 o'clock for you guys on the East Coast. Final college game we'll talk about during the present. The USC Trojans head to Utah to take on the Utah Utes. Utah, of course, just played an LA team, but that was UCLA. UCLA got the upset at home. Now Utah's favorite at home against USC. Surprised me to see. How do I approach? I mean, why is this line the way it is? USC 6-0, Utah's 4-2. Does the home field mean that much? Do you think this line's correct? What's going on?
This line is telling me that Utah's about to blow USC out. That's the only thing that I can say.
So football-wise, like, where's their matchup advantage? How are they going to do that?
Well, the problem with them, remember we spoke about that last week, about the thing that I forgot about when I was handicapping UCLA against Utah, is now you're dealing with Utah moves the ball through tight ends and running game. UCLA moves the ball through running backs and wide receivers. Same with USC. They move the ball with running backs and wide receivers. So chunk plays come a lot easier to the Trojans. With this line that the books are dangling out there, we've been doing this too long, Spread. The first thing you said was, what? It doesn't make sense. When it doesn't make sense, either stay away from it or play the side that doesn't make sense. We know that because these books have not built these billion-dollar facilities from being dumb. This begging you to take USC in those 3.5 type of games, especially with the explosiveness of their offense, with the abilities of Caleb Williams, with the greatness of Jordan Addison. It would say, hey, what are you doing? You're going to get those guys 3.5. For some reason, the books believe that Utah will impose their will on USC, that they're obviously going to give them real problems defensively. You saw how USC looked at Oregon State. Their defense won that game, surprisingly, but Oregon State, which is a lot lesser defense and a lot lesser home field advantage than Utah has, but plays the same style of ball, was able to really give Caleb Williams and that offense some problems. And I think that the books are anticipating that Utah does the same thing. They're going to be fired up. They're coming off getting embarrassed at UCLA. So you're going to get the best ball from the Utes. They know already that their season is in danger of not even winning the Pac-12. Now, they're already pretty much out the playoff picture, but they can still win the conference if they're able to win this game and UCLA slips against USC later in the season. So I think Utah will get the best from them. And if I'm going to play any side on this game, I'll be taking Utah minus 3.5.
He's laying the 3.5. Take the 2.5, lay the 3.5. Old trick if you don't handicap the full game. Let's move into the National Football League. Hopefully these games are more exciting than last night's. The first one, I got to talk about your team. I think this game's fascinating. The Bengals head down to Louisiana to take on the New Orleans Saints. It'll be the homecoming for Joe Burrow and Ja'Marr Chase. Will they get a friendly reception in the stadium? And how do we approach this game? Since we've been talking, this line moved actually on my offshores to -2.5 for the Bengals. This was -1.5 earlier in the week. Do you agree with the line move? And how do you approach this, right? Should I bet on the Cajun carrot, Andy Dalton's?
It's way too much money on Cincinnati, man. The Saints are going to cover this game. I don't know how, but it's no one is taking the Saints at home. And when anytime you see that type of action on one side, you best believe that the other team's going to show up. The Saints defense maybe wake up this week because they looked horrible last week against Seattle. So we maybe see a better performance because I know one thing, Ja'Marr Chase is going to be happy to come home. Joe Burrow is going to be happy to come home.
Do you think people are buying into that on that? Or do you think that it's just
– and they're buying into the fact that the Saints offense is just not that good this year. You know, no one's going to take the offense serious. They didn't take it serious with Jameis Winston. You think they're going to take it serious now with Andy Dalton as the signal caller? So
I mean, they scored 39 last week.
That's what I said. But did he or did Taysom Hill put up 21?
I'm just saying. I say a 39 next to the Saints' name. I'm not too worried about that offense.
I like the Saints in this game, though. If I'm going to take a side on it, I like the Saints. I lean toward the Saints.
Does it get to 3? Do we keep waiting?
It's already at 3. I'm seeing a 3. A 3 okay. -115.
I have a 2.5 offshore.
Vegas Insider showing that the best number that is right now available is Saints +3 -115 on the juice.
All right. Sounds like a plan. The Jaguars and the Colts. You know, I love the Jaguars. I'm not a big fan of the Colts and Matt Ryan, but unfortunately, I don't know, man. This seems like a bit of an overreaction here. I want to take the Jaguars, but another line that confuses me, I thought this was going to be 3, 3.5. Would have been a little more comfortable taking Jacksonville there. That is not the case at all. as this number is minus two now. It's moved between 2.5 and 1.5 all week. So it seems like money's coming in on both sides. I want to take Jacksonville. I want to root for Jacksonville, but I feel like, you know, maybe people are buying into this Colts hype, or, you know, Jags always beat the Colts hype a little bit too much. But they have won 6 of the last 8. They look pretty good against them the first time they played. How do we approach this game?
They have won 6 out of the last 8, but they have lost the last 2 games in Indianapolis. These games are meaning everything to the Colts right now. I think that Jacksonville is going to start showing a little regression because they are young. They are young. Too much money and too many backers are following Jacksonville on this game. The Colts looked horrible. The Colts will be able to run the ball now, even if Jonathan Taylor doesn't come back. What I saw against them and Deion Jackson, the running back that they have, I like him a lot. He has some burst. I think he's going to be able to run the ball on Jacksonville. You see, if you give Matt Ryan time, he can make plays happen. Now, I don't know if you can give him 6 seconds, but they will have the home field advantage. They're a pretty good home team. Frank Reich, you know, I call him done playing with him, but he is a good coach. Thing I like about Reich is that he does make a lot of good halftime adjustments, as we saw against the Broncos. So I think that in a close game that the Colts are able to defend home, they know how big these games are. They're just trying to weather the storm, finding the way that they're going to win games now. They're kind of finding out what they have to do. Low scoring game, protect the ball, and try to keep it close at the end and kind of win the way they won against the Chiefs and the Broncos every game. And I think that them having that type of maturity that they have and type of veteran leadership that they have and experience, that they'll be able to squeak out one against Jacksonville in the same manner, winning late.
That's 2 picks for the teams at home in a dome. Let's head outdoors. The New England Patriots travel to Cleveland to take on the Browns. And right, I mean, it's a different environment with those swirling winds there in Cleveland. This was 3. The books like the people betting like the Patriots, because I see +2.5 now. It's even money on both sides for me offshore at Bookmaker. Browns -2.5. I liked the Patriots at 3. At 2.5, I think, hey, this could probably go either way, right? We saw that game end 30-28 with the Cleveland Browns last week, and they easily could have won that game. So this seems like another one where I wouldn't be surprised that, you know, hey, you could win the bet, but it might feel like a coin flip towards the end. Am I missing an edge here, or am I right to think that this number's right?
Bill Belichick doesn't like Cleveland, as you saw last
year. Oh, good point. Good point. Yeah.
45-7. He has no love for them at all. He has one of the better defenses in the league. He knows Jacoby Brissett really well. He's the one that pretty much gave him his chance, developed him. I think the Browns have a lot of problems moving the ball on the Patriots. Don't get me wrong, the Browns could run the ball on anyone. It just boils down to just like last week against the Chargers. The game's won and Brissett protects the ball. He right there on the goal line throws an interception unnecessarily. Could have just ran the ball in itself or at least took a sack and got points out of the situation. And then you got one of these little rascals again, and they don't want to go against Bill Belichick, man. We saw in the Super Bowl when the little rascal went against Belichick the way he made Sean McVay look, and I think he's going to do the same with Stefanski. Stefanski's going to try to go for it on fourth down or something silly a couple times in his own side of the 50, and the Patriots are going to stuff him. That's going to give a short field for the Patriots. And the Patriots like to run the ball, too. I'm sure the Belichick will be telling his running backs and the offensive line this week, we're going to show them the real way that you run the football. And I like New England in this game just simply because I trust Belichick over Stefanski. And I also like Zappe. As I told you, I'm a fan of his. You saw last week, he's 17 out of 21. He's more than serviceable. He has a coach that's going to put him in situations to play well. I'd be very surprised if Mac Jones is getting his position back if Zappe plays well, because if they can get the best out of Zappe, it might set them up without they can get rid of Mac Jones in the offseason. And now they have even less money tied to the quarterback and build a lot of more stuff, because there's no difference between Zappe and Mac Jones, except for Zappe has a better arm, you know. So,
and he's more mobile.
He moves
better in the pocket. Yeah.
Yeah. He's a good player, man. He's a good player. One of those guys from a small school that I think that Belichick might have found a gem with. And it's the same type of situation with Brady where the starter gets hurt and might fail in his hand. If he plays well this week, I don't think he's going to lose the position anytime soon. So I do like the Patriots in this game, just simply because I don't trust the Fasky.
Yeah, so Five Star saying, take the greatest coach of this era over a little rascal. And he says, we might be seeing Mac Bledsoe here pretty soon. The Baltimore Ravens in New York taking on the Giants. Interesting game. I mean, the numbers don't like the Giants. I'll tell you what, you just look at it. A lot of these projections have this team in the bottom half of the league still, even at 4-1. So people are not buying into the Giants. Still, I don't know, man. I think it's getting to a little bit to the point where it's kind of crazy. They're catching 5.5 at home. They have a really good head coach. Their defensive coordinator used to work in Baltimore. I think that's got to be an edge. I got to think they can keep it close. This Ravens secondary is kind of getting tired towards the end of the game. And guess what? This isn't your mother's Baltimore, right? This team hasn't been able to stop the run that well. So I know that they're getting some people back. That should help. I'm still surprised at this number. I thought it would be closer to +3, +3.5, right? Maybe a +4. 5.5, that's a lot of points. What do you think of the Ravens and Giants?
Yeah, this is one of the games I already played. It's one of my bigger bets of the week. I'm taking the Giants on this game simply because of some of the things that you named. You have Martindale as the DC. He watched every day Lamar in practice. He practiced against him every day. He knows exactly what's going to harm him. And as you and I know, the Ravens don't run this old difficult style of offense like other teams. It's not a lot of thinking to stop the Ravens. You stop the read option, you stop Mark Andrews, you stop the run, and you make Lamar beat you from the pocket. That's pretty much what you're going to do. He's going to have a spy on him, and a good one, because they have some different options that they could use with the Giants, from their safeties, which are veterans, to a couple of the linebackers that they have. I actually think the Giants win this game money line. I think the day ball is that sharp, and I think that we haven't seen the best of the Giants. They're going to continue to get better each week as we go, because Daniel Jones has all the tools to be a good quarterback, man, and he's been there. They've been giving him confidence over the years, but now he finally has the right type of coach that's going to give him the smaller intricacies that he needs in order to be successful. This is the same coach that took Josh Allen and helped him turn the corners. As you remember, as I said, the biggest probably two things for Josh Allen's career, from him becoming a guy who everyone thought might was going to be a bust and was inaccurate and turned the ball over too much, the biggest thing were them going to go get a star receiver. And the second was them getting Daboll as his offensive coordinator. So this guy has a really great grasp of NFL football and how to compete and the things that it takes to win. And I just think that this is going to be a difficult game for Lamar and the Ravens offense. I don't think their offense is going to have much success against the Giants this week. I think it's going to be a battle all the way to the end. And I like the Giants to win, actually money line, but definitely I'll take 6 points.
Who do you like in the main event this week? The Buffalo Bills rematch the Kansas City Chiefs after they're building a rivalry here. What a great game they played in the divisional round of the playoffs last season. Kansas City Chiefs catching 2.5 at home. They opened at 3. They took a little money. I personally agreed with that money, even though I haven't bet it yet. I think that Andy Reid's been saving some tricks here with his new cast of characters that he has around. And I still like Mahomes just a bit more as a quarterback. I think people are buying into the fantasy stuff. I know Josh Allen's the best fantasy quarterback ever, but, you know, running's overvalued for fantasy quarterbacks. I'd like Mahomes to get it done, throw those darts, the home field advantage. Give me Kansas City. What do you think?
Yeah, I agree with you. Did you know that Buffalo are 0-5 and against the spread in their last 5 games on grass?
No, that's a good stat. I didn't know that one.
Yeah, for some reason, they're a turf team now. From where they play it, they're a field turf team. It goes with their speed. They have problems playing on grass for some reason. I don't know if it slows them down or whatever it is. But this game, I got to go with my boy Mahomes, man. I think this is a statement game for him. As we said, this is pretty much the two best quarterbacks, at least the media has said and exalted them as. I could see Mahomes being there. Allen still has something to prove, more than just a great performance last year in the playoffs to me. But, you know, the media takes who they want and they put them on a pedestal. They can shove stuff down your throat so much that soon you believe it. And you remember I sent out a tweet earlier about it's really no reason to even compare Josh Allen at this stage of his career to Mahomes. Mahomes established Allen is trying to become elite. He's on the come up. Don't get me wrong. He's one of the best up and coming quarterbacks. He's playing ball, but he is at Mahomes yet. He hasn't been to two Super Bowls. And people are going to say, oh, what about the team? I think the roster for the Bills last year was very comparable to any of the Chiefs Super Bowl teams. Don't you think so?
Yeah.
Yes. I mean, the Chiefs have anything outstanding that stands out besides Cheetah and Mahomes, you know, Kelsey, those three right there. Look at their defense. You know, that defense has never been lights out or the type of defense where you're going to, you know, be afraid of them. Whereas in the Bills have had the number one defense two straight years in the league. And that still didn't help them beat Kansas City and get to the Super Bowl. So I do definitely like the Chiefs at home. I think it's a statement game. The Bills are 2-6 against the spread in their last eight meetings with Kansas City. So they struggle with them. Mahomes is just hard to beat, man. He's just hard to beat. Even if the Bills get up 20 points in the first half, it doesn't matter. He's still not out of it. So anytime you can get points with Mahomes, you always take them.
All right. You know our listeners are going to want some action on the Sunday night game. The Dallas Cowboys head to Philadelphia to take on the Eagles. During the preseason, I wouldn't have expected myself to be so excited about this game, but now it's turned into must-see TV. Will the Cowboys pass rush, which has looked like the best pass rush in the league, do so against one of the best offensive lines in the league? This isn't the Bengals, who are still coming together. This isn't the Rams, who we've talked about all their issues on the offensive line this season. This is a solid unit that knows how to play football and has been given Jalen Hurts plenty of time. Cowboys catching 6 or 6.5, depending on where you shop. How do you approach this one?
This one I'm going to just watch. I probably won't be involved because my first mind.
The line's like perfect, huh? My numbers came to 6.2 or something.
Yeah, I can't. Because Cooper Rush has been playing decent ball, but what has he done really spectacular? This boils down to now, are you saying the Cowboys are going to out-physical the Eagles the same way they've been out-physical in the other two teams they played, which were the Bengals, the Rams, or the Giants? Are you going to say that they're going to be able to do these same things against the Eagles? It's going to be tough. The Eagles are one of the more physical teams in the league, even though people don't realize they're physical all the way to the quarterback. You don't see Jalen Hurts run out of bounds much. You see him a lot of times drop his shoulder, and no one's even worried about him getting hurt. You know, he's freaking squatting 700 pounds. So, like, the Eagles are one of those teams who I think are very physical, and I also think that they're going to schematically have a big edge on the Cowboys because Sirianni knows what he's doing. They're the number one team scoring in the first half. So if anything, I'd be on the Eagles first half -3.5, -4, or whatever it is, because it's going to take a while for the Cowboys to get it going. Last week, they got some turnovers. They got a block punt. They played some really good ball, team ball last week, but I think that might happen with these numbers just a little bit off. Well, now the public's a little bit too high on them, and you got the Eagles who are going to be extremely pumped up at home to play the Cowboys, and the Eagles' offense right now is clicking. Jalen Hurts is one of the most dangerous quarterbacks in the league. He's definitely probably the top two-way guy right now. He's right there with Lamar. He's one of those guys who getting it done with his feet and his arm. Josh Allen, he's right there with both of those guys. He's really playing well. He's always been a good leader. Their running game is starting to come together. You know, they had great receivers on the outside. And as much as we love to give praise to the Cowboys defensive backs for making interceptions and things like that, they also get beat a lot. So if anything, I lean Eagles actually on this game. Now that I think about it, I do lean Eagles. But if I was going to make a play on the game, it'll be just Eagles first half.
All right. We got a future winner for us. Where should we go when we're looking in the futures tab making bets?
The Texas Longhorns, man. I like everything, like I've told you, out of the Longhorns, especially if Quinn Ewers is there. Quinn Ewers is the difference between the Longhorns being the Longhorns of old and Texas being back. He's able to run that offense that Steve Sarkisian wants to run and implement. He's one of the more accurate passers in the league. And, you know, man for man, Texas simply just has a squad, man. They got players all around because look where they're recruiting from. They're recruiting from cream of the crop, especially in the state of Texas. I think that Texas really also has a chance to actually win the national championship. But the thing is, can they make the playoffs? What's their road to getting into the playoffs with them having two losses? The Alabama loss isn't going to be as big of a deal, but I know for sure that the committee is going to hold back for the loss at Texas Tech. Or talent-wise, there's not too many teams in the country that are better than Texas. So I like Texas definitely to win the Big 12. I found it a plus 250 number, and I also like them to go over 8 on their victories. It's minus 115. So I'll be on Texas a lot the rest of the year. I think that they're coming together at the right time.
All right, Texas finally getting things down there with that program after a couple years of disappointing finishes. Let's move to kick the damn extra point. We each have an award winner this week. We'll start with you.
Got to go with this GM, man, Ryan Poles. I don't know what he's doing. I don't know what he has against his starting quarterback. I don't know if he wants to get in and get his own guy because Pace drafted him and he didn't. But I can't understand why they drafted Velus Jones Jr. when they knew good and well that they had action at a receiver. They needed a new receiver so bad to help this kid out. What we just said, what coordinates with a quarterback growing? And that's having a reliable weapon, someone who's always open, someone he knows is going to be there where he's supposed to be at. He hasn't gotten this guy anything but guys who, like Dante Pettis, he's been out the league like a year, injured, been on several teams. He has all these journeymen out there. He's trying to make the star out the kid from Tulane, but he's like 5'11", wet behind the ears. You know, so I just don't understand what's their plan for this kid at Chicago. And Ryan Poles is not doing a good job with the offensive line. He's not adding any free agents. He's not doing anything to try to make this guy's career more successful. And as the GM, that's your job. That's what you're supposed to be doing. What are you doing by sitting here and you got a draft opportunity to take a top receiver, and instead of taking a receiver or even an offensive lineman, you don't do anything at all to help this kid? Just makes no sense, man. It seems like they're trying to set up the kid to fail. You hire Matt Eberflus, you know, that's a straight defensive mind, which doesn't make any sense. He has no offensive expertise that he could bring and help this kid, but you know you have a rookie quarterback and one of the more talented ones in the league if you can, you know, develop him correctly. I just don't like anything that Ryan Poles is doing. I think he's the wrong guy for the job, and I think that the best thing that could happen for Justin Fields is getting traded from Chicago, getting from under Matt Eberflus, and most of all, getting from under Ryan Poles. So Ryan Poles, kick the damn extra point.
All right, this segment was made for coaches just not making the obvious decision. And my award winner this week specifically did what the title of the segment is. Josh McDaniels, there's over 4 minutes left in the game. Like, what are you doing? Way to take the momentum away from your team. Derek Carr just probably threw the best pass of his season. He was beautiful dime right to Devontae. The momentum's there. I don't even want to talk about the play call. The play call is actually fine. It's the decision to go for two. If there's less than 30 seconds left, I completely support you. You're in Kansas City. You have a chance to win right there. There's no need to go to overtime. There's more than 4 minutes left. You're going to have to stop them anyways. Give your team a chance to win. Don't take all the momentum away. Once again, like you called them, the little rascals are trying to be smarter than the room. They're trying to be smarter than the room, right? They're like screwing around playing Madden online. Like you could just reset the game if you lose. No. Now you have another loss in your column. You got your wide receiver out here throwing his helmet, doing all that other stuff. And it's because he's sick of losing. And it's because little rascals like Josh McDaniels need to kick the damn extra point. Let's move into the ball and parlay. We'll start on Saturday. You got a winner, but the East Coast guys are going to have to stay up late to watch this one.
Yeah, man, it's going to be about midnight if you want to catch this one, guys. If you're in Central Standard or Eastern Standard Time, we got to go out on the West Coast. I have some of my most success on these late night games because it seems like the books go to sleep at that time. They're tired from winning all game, and they leave a little bit open for us at night. We're going to go with San Jose State. They're -8 on the road at Fresno State, and I'm not usually one to give up points on the road in conference, but this one is a mismatch, and it's a lot of things San Jose State has going in their favor and a lot of things Fresno State has going against them that makes this game clear and obvious to me. San Jose State begins its conference play with 3 consecutive wins. They have a transfer quarterback, Chevin Cordero from Hawaii. This kid can play. He's been more than solid under center. Most of all, he protects the ball. 6 touchdowns, no interceptions, no fumbles. In fact, Spartans lead the country in protecting the ball. San Jose had its first turnover of the year last week when it dismantled UNLV 40-7. Their offense has been effective and efficient, which complements this veteran defense perfectly. Defense has always been at the forefront for Coach Brent Brennan's team. This season, he may have his best unit since he's been the coach there. Their defense is 10th in points allowed, nationally only yielding 14 points per game. That's bad news for a Fresno State team that's reeling. They lost their star quarterback to a high ankle sprain against USC. He was a really good player, Jake Haener. And Jake Haener not being under center for them is really hurting Fresno State. They're nothing like the team that they were before. They're also missing a star receiver. Kalen DeBoer, who was their coach, is gone. He's with Washington now. His replacement is Jeff Tedford, who is on the second stint at Fresno. Old school coach, not as new thinking as DeBoer, not as innovative as DeBoer was. Jeff Tedford is going to be at home after two disappointing losses. They got blew out by a Boise State team that's not good last week. Now Logan Fife under center. This guy's thrown no touchdown passes, four interceptions this year. Last year, they steamrolled San Jose State 40-9, and Haener had four touchdown passes. I expect this to be on Brett Brennan's mind. San Jose State is one that lasts by an average of 26 points, so they're on blowout mode. They're trying to really hand it to people, and I know that this is a get-even game. Like, hey, you guys smoked us last year. Now we're going to come on your field and smoke you the way you smoked us. You kicked us while we were down. Now it's our turn to kick you back. Fresno is 0-6 against the spread in their last six games overall, while the Spartans are 4-0 against the spread in their last four games overall. Take San Jose to show no mercy to their conference rival, San Jose State, Mind State, over a beat of Fresno State team.
All right, I'm going to go with the team that's playing its second straight road game on the East Coast. Normally you think that's bad, but no. San Francisco and these guys have figured it out. What they do is they use it as kind of like a mini training camp in season. They stay in West Virginia, and they've always had good success when they've done it. The players have bought in under Shanahan. They all understand, hey, God, it's like running training camp one more week. We stay out there. We don't have the extra distractions on our way to practice. They've covered three out of the four times that they've done this. Three of the covers were just absolutely easy. Also, look at the San Francisco game, just how they match up, regardless of that preparation tidbit there. For Atlanta to have success against the San Francisco 49ers, they're going to have to run the ball. I don't think they're going to be able to do that against this stout front seven. And I think San Francisco will put up points against an Atlanta defense that hasn't been the strongest this season. You get some more Debo Samuel. Brandon Ayuk probably has a good game, and this team will be able to run the ball. So give me the team with the best defense, the team that can establish the run, and the team that's got the good mojo after spending a week together, just getting ready to have another successful East Coast trip. They got Matt Rhule fired in their last outing. Arthur Smith will probably keep his job after this loss, but maybe get some people thinking, as I think San Francisco absolutely blows out the Atlanta Falcons and heads home with a lot of momentum. So we're going to take San Jose State Saturday night and then San Francisco Sunday morning.
The 49ers would be the first team to cover this year against the Falcons. Do you know the Falcons are the only team undefeated against the spread?
I think that's giving us a discount, though, don't you?
I hope so, because I played them on a teaser. Let me throw in a bonus real quick for the people. Rams minus 10. I don't usually give up double digits in the NFL, but this time it's more than necessary. Carolina just fired his head coach, Matt Rhule. Lost his starting quarterback, Baker Mayfield, all in the same week. That means that the Panthers will be traveling to the world champs who just got embarrassed by the Cowboys with Steve Wilkes, who we've seen at Arizona. He isn't that good of a coach. P.J. Walker, who has never won a game in the NFL as a starting quarterback and also has only two touchdown passes and eight interceptions in those times starting. I think that the little rascal catches some sense this week, realizes what he's doing by making his lineman continually backpedal and let him move forward this week. Give the ball to Cam Akers and let Cam Akers run the ball. Get out of his feelings. They've been struggling since that beginning game when they lost to the Bills, and he surprised everyone by keeping Cam Akers out of the game the whole first half. I think he gets his senses back, realizes, hey, man, we're about to fall off the map if we don't pick it up. Run Cam Akers at the Panthers. The Panthers aren't a good team, man. They just aren't a good team, even with everyone. And now they're dealing with all this turmoil. Stafford has been sacked 21 times, so I've got to believe that McVay's a lot smarter this week with the way he runs his offense. Stop trying to make Cooper Kupp freaking Hall of Famer, man, and just use all of your weapons on the team. And I think they do that this week. I think the Panthers are overmatched against the Rams, and I really think that the Rams lay the wood to them. So we're going with the Rams minus 10 as my NFL pick for the week. Anything for the people spread before we get out of here?
No, I'm going to just be excited for this weekend. I put those bets in for all the college games you broke down, so I will have action all day on Saturday. Moving into NFL Sunday. So thank you for that, and looking forward to breaking these games down on Monday. See where we got it right, see where we got it wrong.
Spread rolling with the San Francisco 49ers minus 5.5. He likes the fact that they stayed out east, which they do all of the time, which is very smart. And they're going to Atlanta. And I got San Jose State with some get back on their mind after getting massacred last year. And I also threw in as a bonus the Rams minus 10. I think the Rams will have it on their mind to get their season back situated. You guys follow my guy Spread at Spread Astaire. Follow me at 5-Star in Vegas. Pull out the 5. Hey, man, go Astros tomorrow, Saturday in Seattle. The Grim Reaper comes. Mariners, you guys had a great season. We'll see you next year. See ya.